Welcome once again. We have with us, so far we have Mr. Devashish Singh, Senior VP and Global CIO Emphasis, Mr. Harnath Babu, CIO KPMG India, Mr. Moires Purandare, Head IT, Infrastructure and Security, Marico, Mr. Sanjay Kotha, Joint President and Group CIO, Adani Enterprise, Mr. Umesh Mehta, ABP and Global CIO, Jubilant Life Sciences, and Mr. Naveen Gulati, CIO, Gunnarsau. And apart from our partner, Tata Communication, we have Mr. Rajarshi Purkayastha, Head Pre-Sales, India and SAR, and Makta. Let me quickly brief you about the flow. We'll have Mr. Purkayastha give a brief intro to the topic, and then we'll have specific questions for each of the panelists. A sincere request, please keep your comments to 2 to 2.5 minutes in the first round so that we'll have some time for an open discussion after that. I'll not take much time and we'll straight away request Mr. Purkayastha to introduce the topic briefly, and then we'll get into the discussion.
Thanks, Shamanuja. I'm hoping my voice is loud and clear.
Yeah.
So, as you mentioned, when you talk about transformation is a journey that, you know, each and every one of you is there in some shape or form. You know, I know for a fact I've discussed, transformation in detail with few of you also. However, transformation, when we look at, there are multiple parts which come in. And, when we think about resiliency, when we think about, going deep into stacks and so on and so forth, one thing that may or may not be sidelined is agility. And many a times, specifically COVID taught us that agility is something that is, that should be a fundamental pillar in our IT stack, right? Specifically in our enterprise architecture. Today's discussion will focus on agility and see if agility is something that can be sidelined, or is it something which is an and rather than an or? Because, as I was speaking to Shyam yesterday, and he said that in one of his discussions, he found that resiliency and agility is something that is being, kind of looked at in two different mirrors. And few people actually focus on resiliency rather than agility. And I don't agree to that. Maybe, we'll hear from all of you in terms of how you look at agility and in the transformation journey that you have. Shyam, back to you.
Oh, thank you. Thank you. So, yes. That was really quick and good. So before we get into the discussion, I'd like to tell the audience something, which is watching it live, that you have quiz questions after the session, which will fetch you points to take you up in the leaderboard and make you move closer to the top prizes like Maruti Baleno and Sony Bravia TV and a lot more, not for the panelists. let's get started with the discussion. Let's start with Mr. Kotha. What drives infrastructure transformation for you? In a group with such a diverse portfolio from, edible oil to huge, large infrastructure, and with a network of global supply chain, it could mean so many things to so many businesses at different stages. So how do you, at group level, you look at that? Yeah.
Thanks, Shyam, for that. Yeah, it's a very interesting question, and I think this is something what we are trying to live every day in our lives. And Rajshri, in fact, lay the good foundation about being agility and resilience. I think transformation, if you look at, if one has to give a raw definition, is about you transforming your people, process, technology, and of course, this is related with the business. And how do you do with the business, which is very critical. And agility, to my point, mind is one of the critical points. Resilience is about your infrastructure of you being able to keep your things up and working. At a group level, since we are very diverse, so it's not a transformation which kind of works for all, because every business has got their own nuances and the way they work. But it's important you look at transformation across multiple domains, whether it's about business, you know, in within business about process, you know, transformation, technical transformation, the agility around culture, the agility around change management. I think these are some key parameters which I believe, you know, will have to drive transformation today, looking at digital, and there is a force and push and pull, because the amount of technology which is working and, you know, you're moving your organization to adapt the digital way of doing itself is a foundation for the transformation. So there, and it cannot be a digital transformation, cannot be an agenda for the CIOs. I think, you know, what at our organization, we have made it a point that a digital transformation is a board level agenda point where every CEO is an owner of the transformation, and the skills which IT or tech teams have is to bring in the technologies to meet that goal and the vision of the organization. So at our organization, I think we have taken a big leap of faith in digitization, and a lot of disruptive things are being done where we have built digital teams across all the BUs. We have recently put a digital lab to create a super app for all our consumer businesses, be it gas, electricity, airports, where there is a consumer touch. We are building a similar culture around B2B businesses. So transformation is happening across all the domains. On one side, looking at a business customer, on other side, looking at an end consumer at the same time. And how does it take organization to give great experience to these consumers and create value for them for the services which they use today and give them one stop answer? So let me pause there. And as we go forward, we can just go into details.
Sure. Thanks, Mr. Kota. So let me turn to Mr. Mehta and ask him the question that, you know, Raj mentioned in the beginning, which is he referred to our conversation yesterday, is this whole thing about resilience. Of course, now there is everyone in IT is talking about resilience, business resilience, and people are looking at IT for providing that resilience to them. And on the other hand, you know, in many businesses, almost in all businesses today, you have to be agile, you have to transform, you have to be agile. Yet, you know, this resilience is something which has now firmly entered the mind of the top board CEO. So are they, and some are, as he said, some are looking at trade-offs. Okay, so for time, let's focus on resilience and then we'll think about being agile later. So what is your take?
So first of all, thank you, Shyam, for having me on this discussion, panel discussion. To me, agility means doing something new, discovering how well it works, and assessing whether it achieves the desired results. Also, an ability to adapt quickly while increasing the customer focus. So that means keep doing things, keep doing new things, try new things, But as apart from this, the resiliency also has to be there, because Sanjay was mentioning, the keeping the lights on should always be there. So the system has to be has to be resilient enough to run and to keep the operations running, and that is very important. And with this pandemic, we have learned that we were just discussing before this panel that a lot of people or a lot of workforce have moved to their native places, and a lot of companies have moved their resources to cloud also. So, and cloud doesn't mean that you move your loads to cloud and you become resilient. Okay, so there are a lot of things which you need to take care when you talk about the resiliency. And in fact, the importance of resilience grows when you move your cloud and when you have your workforce coming from anywhere in the world to access your resources. So that is a very important thing. And most of the, in our organizations, we already adopted cloud around 3-4 years back. And the only thing what changed was the connectivity. Okay. So now we are implementing SD-WAN solutions so that we have secure connectivity from anywhere to the cloud. And we have local breakouts also from our sites. so that the directly traffic can go rather than coming from a node. Earlier, all the traffic used to come to our single node, and from there we were going out. So that has now gone, and we have given local breakouts to get a better performance to our users, so that they can access their loads seamlessly. So resiliency, I would say, is a very, very important for operations to run. And that's my take.
Thank you, Mr. Mehta. See, Raj, actually, I wanted to come to you with this question a little later, but now that Mr. Mehta has brought in, so let me ask you right away. Then I'll come to Mr. Babu and Mr. Singh. Is the same point, you know, what are you seeing with the customers? Almost everyone is looking, either talking about it, as Mr. Mehta, some have done it, okay, is from these MPLS-based VPN to shifting to SD-WAN for both cost and performance reasons. Do you think this is happening as a strategy, or it is a knee-jerk reaction? And number two, then there is question of security, secure access. When you do, is SD-WAN good enough for that, or something else has to be done? And maybe if you can talk about even the cloud connectivity. Okay. So I wanted to ask this question to you a little later, but I think this is, he has already got the, us there. So please, quickly. Yeah.
Sure. So, you know, we have worked with Mr. Umesh and his team very closely. And I can tell you that none of the customers today are moving to SD-WAN as a knee-jerk reaction, right? Because let me give the background out here. See, when you have shifted your app stack to cloud, the first thing which will happen is that you would look at a different type of connectivity, because your employees would now access those applications on internet, right? Now, when you think about, so for example, Mr. Devashish said that he's back to office, right? And if one of his apps is sitting in AWS cloud, if the office is connected only on MPLS, and then from earlier architecture of, you know, go to the data center, break out from there, his productivity and his experience for that app stack will go down drastically, right? That is the reason why almost all customers are looking at both internet and MPLS, depending on where the applications are in the office, right? Now, when you do that, how do you control which application will go to MPLS, which application will go to internet? You can't control that from normal routing kind of a thing, right? That's where SD-WAN comes in. And therefore, what we see as a general trend from all the enterprises is that there's a shift towards SD-WAN. Once they shift to cloud, there's a shift towards SD-WAN. It is a logical shift or a logical direction going forward. However, in that, one more important thing that comes to play is that when you go into multiple clouds, there are some optimized way of cloud-to-cloud communication which needs to happen, right? Which is, again, some kind of, you know, directional change that we are seeing. Because, you know, think about it, you may have some applications on AWS, you may have analytics from Google, you may be using Teams or O365 from Microsoft. And therefore, as a user, you will go to all three of them, right? Now, when you're going to all three of them, are you going to get the optimized experience? Maybe not, because, you know, internet may not be the best suited for all these things. There is where you need more optimized kind of connectivity. So the network of today is actually becoming more complex, because you have to go to multiple different cloud instances on internet, even on a private network. Because, you know, if you talk to Mr. Kota, you'll say that I'll surely keep one instance on the private cloud, right? He will go to public cloud, of course, but he'll have some instances on his private cloud also. So his MPLS will remain. So with that as a background, obviously SD-WAN plays a very, very important role for user experience and the resiliency at the back of it.
Thank you. So let me turn to Mr. Singh. often when it started, you know, the pandemic and the you talk to IT industry, they think that we are used to remote working, so it is nothing new for. See, on your convenience and sometimes once in a while working, remote working, so making it work is one thing. And then now we are hearing that, you know, from TCS and other companies, like 70%, 60%, these numbers will work remotely. So you have to plan this hybrid work culture, hybrid workspace, which is being talked about. It is not just that a guy goes out and he is able to work. It is like you have to plan organization-wise for that. So what kind of infrastructure transformation does that require? Not just being able to get a few people, you know, get into the network and get working, but planning it the way that, you know, maybe 30%, 40% will sit in a distributed manner and maybe even smaller offices. Now people are moving to smaller locations. So with all that taken into consideration.
So I'll say it's a great question, Sam. Everybody wanted to transform in the possibly pre-pandemic era. And there are enough challenges thrown at the technology leaders, right? Be it budget challenges, be it adoption challenges, or even the commitments from the top leaders and so on and so forth. And that is what we used to discuss all the time in different forums. So with pandemic, what happened? All of a sudden, overnight, the expectation changed and it was a requirement and that's a question of survival that you have to move people to a distributed and spread environment. Overnight, kind of companies moved from 1 or 10 offices to possibly multi-thousand offices. I mean, if I talk about Emphasis, we're roughly running around 30,000 plus offices today. And that is what the key part we need to kind of keep in mind when you are moving from a defined controlled environment, because offices are the controlled environment. You have a defined network, you have monitoring system mechanism to kind of ensure everything works the way it is. From there, you are moving to a very, very uncontrolled public environment. And take, for example, particularly India, where the connectivity is not that robust and mature compared to the Western countries, you get into challenges which is possibly do not have a straight answer, like somebody connecting a dongle from some place in Imphal, which doesn't have proper coverage. What are you going to do? Ask the employee to come back to a city or allow the employee to work? So that is where your kind of design component comes in, how to handle those traffics, possibly at a local level or at a region level, rather than consolidating, bringing them together to your centralized or a resilient environment, whatever you would have brought in multiple data centers or so on and so forth. So that is what, and one of the study done by IDC published, I think, a few months back, the cloud adoption, because of this requirement, got advanced almost 3 to 4 years. Because everybody started moving to cloud, and we know what happened to Zoom as well, right? The platform we are talking today. So, and now things are changing and we are seeing the reverse side of it as well. So the adoption to the cloud definitely doesn't happen just like that. You have to keep a lot of aspect in mind, and Rajasri was talking about how to ensure the traffic movement between multi-cloud. Because every enterprise you talk about today, they are definitely in a hybrid cloud environment. So there will be certain amount of Azure, certain amount of AWS, maybe GCP, maybe on-prem, hyper-converged platform, so on and so forth. So how to ensure that your traffics are optimized and giving the best experience to your stakeholder, to your customers, to your employees. And that is what the design component comes in. If you start talking, it will probably continue a day, but from a design requirement standpoint, we need to really work with partners. We have one partner, of course, sponsored by Tata Communication. So that is how to kind of bring this connectivity and the platform part and ensure what is your network origination or the resources origination, and from that point, how it is getting distributed to the local employees spread across, right? You can't run a single resource at a centralized place anymore. You have to look at a distributed architecture. If you are running any platform, suppose you are running an ERP, can I run ERP in one center now? So if you want to run multi-center, then what is the answer? How to do it? Should I put multiple ERPs? No, absolutely not. But how I can ensure my traffic gets optimized and accelerated to reach to that level, that location, so that the employee gets the right experience, the customer gets the right experience. So that is, a lot has to go into the design side of it. Of course, keeping security and other aspect in mind.
Okay. Oh, thanks. Yeah. So, let me turn to Mr. Babu. See, you have similar being a global industry, people are very, very used to remote working. But unlike in case of Mr. Singh, here, it is much lesser number of people and with more, floating around. So does that require too much of change? And if yes, then what? Basically, people have been consultants. In fact, one of the thing I was told in some early in my career, I was asked to take a test. I wanted to become a consultant, and I failed in the first one. How is your willingness to travel? Okay, so and consultants are all with today somewhere. So that is already there. So what kind of change is needed, if at all, to support this? Has the pandemic changed something, or the new digitization? Of course, new technologies are coming, but is there a fundamental shift?
Sham, so I think it's a great question. And certainly, I think, let me just set some perspective. So I think from the earlier times, things have changed. As we speak, we are almost 29,500 people in the country from a size perspective. We're not limited to any specific service. Obviously, we give services like audit, tax, which are specific to compliance or statutory requirements, to advisory. And again, during the pandemic, I would say the thrust on consulting industry was way too high, because if the business is going up, you need a consultant. If the business is going down, you need a consultant, right? Irrespective of whichever situation you are in, statutory deadlines and compliances are supposed to be met. So you have no choice, right? So I think one of the biggest challenge, I would say, from a business perspective is, how do you continue to stay up online and make sure that you're able to meet the demands of the customers? We were working with Government of India. We were working with large organizations, or large clients. We were working with smaller clients, just to make sure that these services were given. And the whole transformation journey that many of our clients have taken, I think we've been part of those journeys, for sure. So having said that, what has changed for us, right? I think one was, to your point, we were always prepared to work from remote, but the preparedness was only to a certain percentage. So if I have to just give you a perspective, maybe 30-35% was the staff which typically floats around or goes to clients. Most of the offices would be equipped to host around 60-65% of the strength, right? So we have fairly large offices across the country. The biggest change that happened was, one fine day we just had to go remote, right? And there was no option, obviously. There was no choice, there was no option. So we did quickly on, I mean, I would say not even a single day we took, but we kind of went completely remote. Obviously, we used the right kind of infrastructure, or it was a matter of scaling up our current infrastructure that we had, right? So, and that's the first thing. Second is, we always had, in a consulting industry, what's important is to stay ahead in terms of, technology. Because when you go and talk to your clients, you can't say that I'm lagging behind on tech. You have to be ahead in terms of technology. So be it cloud, or be it, cloud native applications, or be it cloud collaboration, you will have to constantly stay, stay ahead. Which also meant that we always had, cloud first strategy. We believe that anything that comes in new from a technology perspective, we should experiment with that. And I think that somewhere led us to be more prepared. So as we started getting into the whole pandemic situation, obviously, while people were working from remote, there were challenges, right? And I'm sure most of the people or most of the CIOs would have faced the challenge in terms of, you know, availability of skill sets to, because you were moving very fast. So you had to have the right kind of skill sets who were really managing your new type of workloads that you are managing suddenly. Or you had to respond to clients' requirements because clients started pushing you on some of the digital transformation initiatives. So you obviously had to have people. And again, that's the reason it's a crazy time for most of us, because talent is again drying up. So I think we had to just keep all of these things together and make sure that we are able to support our people while they're working from remote, not only from an infra point of view, but also from a health and well-being perspective, right? So they were, I mean, it's a long journey that we have covered in a year and a half. But to your point, Shyam, I think what's important is, you know, it's important to stay agile. And again, to my earlier point, I think continue to experiment, continue to respond quicker. And as resiliency happens, I mean, it happens to be one of the key components, right? Because as I think, as Rajshree was mentioning, when, you know, when you get back to office or when you are working in a hybrid environment, you will not find everybody coming back to the offices, right? So you'll have people working from remote, you'll have people working from offices, part of them, you will need to rethink of how the whole infrastructure will run for you, right? And to the point of what Devashish was mentioning is, you know, it's not anymore, your people are sitting in a perimeter, you know, in a boundary where they're operating from. So you practically have, as we speak, 30,000 people sitting out of the offices. It's like candle in the wind, right? From a security point of view, do you have the right kind of security architecture? Do you have the right kind of access mechanism for, you know, the data? Because it's, again, it's not a software code. It's not, you know, an application. It's about the client data that we're talking about. And these are very critical sensitive data, right? So you have to make sure that this information is protected, which is practically sitting on every machine, whichever consultant or whichever auditor is working on a particular type of data set, the data is secure. So I think quite a lot has gone in. We have implemented zero trust architecture. We have gone from a conventional proxy to, let's say, cloud proxy. We have upgraded our virtual private network using the same ZTA. So I think, and again, to your earlier point, you know, I think the need for MPLS is now, as we get back to offices, need for MPLS is going to come down. Because I think Rashi was alluding to that. You need to start accessing applications which are on the cloud, right? So as we speak, Zoom is on the cloud, or Teams is on the cloud, or there are a lot of applications that we build for our clients or for ourselves, they're on the cloud. So, and many of them are, you know, accessing from home or from offices, doesn't matter. I think you have to necessarily rethink the whole network with which you're able to access the applications, and maybe SD-WAN could be a possible solution. Do away with MPLS, hook on to ILL, and start, you know, shifting your network towards SD-WAN. So I think some of those architectural changes, and along with ZTI, which I mentioned earlier, are happening. But quite an exciting time for all of us, for sure.
Thank you. So we'll probably come back to that international global thing. But before that, I think we have taken a good amount of time talking about how the change in work structure, remote work and hybrid workplace has changed. Now, let me turn to Naveen, okay. Let me talk about the other aspect, which is, see, consumers going online and doing more online transactions and, you know, and thus, you know, the online transaction volumes actually going up significantly. So since you are a kind of, you know, born online company, okay. So have you seen some major change since the pandemic has happened? So, and so what is the response in terms of infrastructure transformation there? So the other aspect on the front end, the client side, customer side, sorry.
Hi, thanks, Shyam. A very interesting question. So, you know, one thing that happened with us right at the onset of this pandemic was we saw a huge surge in the traffic. It was almost 3x, 3.5x the volumes, the monthly volumes that we were serving. And for us, a pure B2C digital native company, our revenues went to almost zero, right? So it was a huge seesaw ride for us. Money going down, traffic going up, right? Because everyone's home, people had good time to spare, right? And then automobiles is one thing that almost everyone is passionate about, right? So that happened. And overall, our architectures had always been in an auto scaling mode. We are a purely public cloud hosted company, and that's how we had designed our systems. So we were able to handle the surge pretty well. One thing that runs culturally in the entire group is that no matter what, the customer experience is always of paramount importance to us. So we handled that well. Of course, there were platforms which were not ready to handle such a surge of traffic. We had to work very closely with the tech teams. We had to get the environment infrastructure ready. And honestly, for us, that's where the leverage of cloud came in. We didn't have to go through the entire purchase to the implementation cycle before you really get the new infrastructure in place, right? And that also helps us contain our costs to a greater extent. Fast forward to today, we are working very heavily on converting a few of our monolithic applications to microservices-based architectures. And that would help us even prepare better for upcoming future, because what has happened in an automobile industry is that for almost a year and a half, you had no new car launches taking place. And now there's a sudden rush. You see EVs are very, very interesting space. It's picking up well. Even other ICE engines are picking up well. There are a lot of new exciting models coming out, and that's all happening back to back now. Right, so we are well positioned. We are well geared for the next surge of traffic per se. Right, so this is how we handled, and this is how we are shaping things ahead for the future.
Thank you. So that gives me an idea. I would have come to Raj, but let me first go to Mayuresh, and then we'll come back. Ask Raj to respond to that. Application modernized applications are the driver of infrastructure transformation, but let's hold on for some time. Marasi, we talked about online transaction, we talked about remote working, but at the end of the day, how much beats move around, atoms will still move, right? And in your, and we need to eat, we cannot eat, beats. So And India is a growing market with, and continuously companies are trying to reach out to smaller locations. You have supply chain, you have the distribution network, you have the customers who are at different places, they have to be reached out. So once that kind of growth is happening, not internationally, and we're not talking of, internally, which is like work culture and all, but actually the business and going deeper and deeper into India. And as all of us have already said, and everyone says that communication quality is not always great in India and all this. So what kind of infrastructure transformation does that kind of proposition drive?
Thanks, Shyam. I think it's a great question. Because what I heard you say, and most of the people said so, that unfortunately, India is not having a good infrastructure, and people still have to struggle a lot to connect back to the application that they're using. We have seen a little different trend there. So Marico is one of those organizations who have implemented a DMS, which is called a distributor management system, in early 1990s. We were the first ones to take orders via SMS streams, because at that time, even 2G data wasn't available. So there used to be a stream of SMSs going out of the modem, which was kept at the distributor's site. And from there, then we moved to a DMS, which is sitting at the distributor's end. Right? With this pandemic, actually, we are moving to shift the gear, and we are actually trying to move to cloud-based DMS. And earlier, the premise was not all the distributors would have a good network. They may not be able to access the cloud. But actually, we are changing that. And we are now moving all our distributors to the cloud. I remember we also have mobile applications for our sales teams, right? So we used to have an architecture in such a way that maximum data stays on the mobile and only once or twice a day, they are syncing up with the cloud or with the servers earlier, right? So that is also shifting, right? We are also trying to create applications which are more and more online and they can get the real-time data of the customers. So with that, actually, we are changing the strategy a little bit. We are trying to put things on cloud as much as we can. Give the data back into the hands of the people who are facing the customer. And that is changing our strategy of modernizing infrastructure because those are the need of the time.
Okay, thank you. Thank you. So we have covered that. So we have covered, you know, getting deeper into India, the work culture, the transformation, the more digitalized offerings, digital consumers. Before I actually asked that question, which I was talking about application, modernized application as a driver. One more question I think we should get from Mr. Kotha, Mr. Mehta, Mr. Babu. So all who are, have significant global presence, either as a supply chain, in some cases as customers or employees, whichever way. India is at some stage, there is something which is happening. Of course, certain cloud is a global phenomenon. So when you have to get into, and especially in case of, say, Mr. Kotha, so it is not always, the big cities of the US or UK. So there are different kind of places that you get into because of the supply chain and other offices, and you get into newer markets in infrastructure and all. Okay, so and out of India, you are primarily your core is still in India, right? So what kind of challenges that bring you when it comes to planning your infrastructure? Maybe you can start with Mr. Kotha.
So I think today's time and world is changing so fast and rapidly. And there are no point solutions, for you to build in the legacy. The market has come up with so many different kind of application portfolio. Now, for example, getting a service assigned globally is not a big deal today because we are putting our systems on cloud and they are as easily accessible whether you are in India or in Australia or in Singapore, Dubai. It doesn't matter to us where they are. But important thing is about the processes. I think that is always a challenge, whether it is package to process or you do process to package and you keep on customizing. And it's a hard, decision which is taken in the organizations time to time. We have taken that decision saying that, whatever application or wherever we go to the new market, leave the regulatory separate because that is something law of the land which you always have to abide with. But in terms of business processes, if they have worked in India, they have worked in Australia, I'm sure they will work in Singapore also. And there may be small nuances. So we typically present and push for package to process. And, we already have the off-the-shelf, systems, which are all global systems and they're configurable to that extent. And that's the journey we have embarked on. Now, how do you do it? For example, you have the SAPs of this world. You can't just go and customize the code in an SAP, but you can customize a few tables here and there. Now, when you look at the business agility, and again, I'm going to touch on agility and resilience because I realize that it is not agility or resilience, it is and actually, it is agility and resilience which have to go hand in hand. So giving that perspective here also in a global market is how do you make and work your application? Because your business process have to be given through a technology, forget platform, which is cloud, data getting generated, but what are those applications? So we have embarked on a journey of looking at creating a no code, low code kind of a platform. And that's what is helping us also majorly to be able to customize, you know, small things for the small markets while we maintain and manage the overall enterprise architecture. So everything is sitting within the architecture and we are allowing the businesses to play within that architecture, which does not damage the ethos of the organization at the same time. So it's a tricky thing. You know, there's always a push and pull which will happen with the business CEOs because, you know, they'll always say that this process is very critical and we have to do it this way. And that's where, you know, we, you know, the earlier question you asked about transformation, you know, one of the roles which I am playing is also of the business transformation, helping the CEO to say that, you know, can we do this process in a very different way? We don't know if it's effective or not, but, you know, can we get away from the legacy thought process and look at the value creation, therefore? And that's what I believe, you know, as CIOs, the way we are moving and getting into digital transformation is also to own some part of business within you. If you just sit on the other side and wait for the business to demand and ask, you will be always going and fulfilling their needs through various technologies. But if you go and sit in their shoes and become a partner in that, I think the situation is changing. And that's what we see both in India or the countries where we are embarking, whether we are building a new port in Sri Lanka, Myanmar, we have a business in Australia and other countries. So it's getting simple. Of course, there's always an expectation, you know, which you have to manage. And I think that's why we exist there to create that value and tell the business why it is so important or not.
Absolutely, absolutely.
Thank you.
Okay, so let me come to Raj for that question, which I was, which came to me after, you know, Naveen spoke. You know, see, many start, you know, with seeing the benefits of many businesses, many of the financial services, many of the consumer online services, they want to avail the advantages of this modernized application. And while some of them are on cloud, private cloud, mostly private cloud, whatever. When they want to do it on a, and many of them are, you know, kind of have been formed after acquisition mergers over a period of time and with different disparate technologies. So in that case, what do you see? And it is quite common these days to see, you know, a lot of acquisition in those spaces. Okay. So when you are consolidating, you are trying to give the employees, the customers, a seamless experience, but at the same time, so you can probably call it some kind of agility, whatever name you give it to it, but at the same time, trying to, you know, make it more efficient, your infrastructure, you optimize for the needs. So it is all happening at the same time. So what kind of challenges do you see? And what are the approaches that people generally take to meet those challenges?
Sure. It's a good question. And what I'd say is that, you know, even amongst, you know, all the eminent panelists here, I've heard different things. You know, I can start with Mayuresh. You know, Marico changes their supply chain architecture every 3 to 5 years. And I think, you know, that's the norm that they have, right? Whereas, you know, if we talk about any other company which actually services customers, where the customers, you know, come and access a part of your services through a platform, there changing the architecture becomes difficult, right? Because, you know, you have an end customer which is coming and doing something on top of it, and you cannot just touch a production system and, you know, expect it to work seamlessly while the change is ongoing, right? And that's the worry that almost all the CIOs and the CXOs have in their mind, that should I really touch a production system? However, as Mr. Sanjay said, or you know, Mr. Hanad said, what we are seeing today is that, you know, change from monolithic to a different kind of an architecture where app modernization is happening, where you're looking at, you know, a CI/CD pipeline more because you want to make things agile, is the reality today. And this is happening because the competition is forcing the enterprises to look at things, or the consumers of the services is forcing that, right? they are saying that, look, I want the following features. If you have a monolithic architecture, adding features on top of it becomes very difficult. Whereas if you build it on microservices and you have a CI/CD pipeline and agile methodology to do it, you'll be able to do or add things, you know, very fast. Now, this has a huge implication. It doesn't just mean that, you know, you'll write a code and you know, and that's it, right? Because, you know, you'll have to look at, is it on AIX today? Is it on Intel today? Where is it hosted at this point of time? How, you know, are you going to look at the test and develop dev environment? Can you look at, you know, doing it in a pocket and then pushing it across the production environment and so on and so forth, right? But, you know, I like something which Mr. Sanjay said. In today's day, a lot of these can be kind of packaged, right? And you can have a package created and you can say that, hey, if you have a monolithic architecture, following other steps that you take and then to, you know, convert it into a microservices / a CI/CD pipeline, if you do 1, 2, 3, 4, 200 steps, you would be able to do it whether you are in India or in Australia, right? So those kind of things is possible today. It was not as simple, you know, in 2005 or what Mayuresh was saying, right? Late 90s, you wouldn't think about things like this. Today, it is very much possible. And therefore, you know, all the CXOs and the eminent panelists out here, I see that they are actually taking advantage of this and deploying things which can be then given to the consumers on the fly.
Right. So anyone, so on this aspect, anyone would like to comment quickly? We have about 5 minutes more. So, and then we'll close.
Go ahead.
Okay. Very quickly, I'll take a couple of minutes. Umesh and I'll give back to you. So we use something for our customers and as well as internally. And we call that as front to back transformation. What does it mean is we spoke about monolithic application, we spoke about ERPs, we spoke about legacy systems. And that is the biggest challenge in the industry. Those who adopted technology ahead of others, they are sitting with all those legacy, nobody wants to touch them. I mean, talk about large banks across the globe, nobody wants to touch their backend because no one knows what changes and how it is really functioning, to be very honest. So that's the reality, right? But at the same time, they have to compete with cloud-born fintechs as well and bring that experience to your customers, to your employees, how you will do it. And that is what front-to-back transformation is all about. And what we do is, while your backend remains as it is, create a front-end which is absolutely newest, aligned, whatever the features or whatever you want to deliver to your customers. In the middle, bring the connectors, bring the services, microservices, bring the data out of it. You know what the data you are sitting with. And that is what the wealth today. And apply all the cognitive technologies on top of that, starting from analytics to machine learning to AI. Apply on those and produce those outputs and probably give those capability or the intelligence to your consumers, to your customers in the front end. Because front end, you can change anytime. And I was touching upon the last time when I was talking about the legacy or the ERPs and so on and so forth. I believe I will not be surprised in a few years down the line, all the ERPs will become a backend system only. It will only the core teams are going to access the ERP, but across the enterprise, people will only deal with a single front end, which may be a mobile app or whatever the front end you have, and that giving the intelligence, whatever required, which is highly personalized for that persona or that individual. And that is what the trend we are seeing it. We practice it internally. We do it for our customers. Absolutely. For living. And that is the way applications procedure is going to change the world.
Thank you. So, Mr. Mehta, quickly, yeah. And then we'll.
So I would like to add again, see, you can't change the core system. You can't change the core SAP. Okay, so you have to build peripheral applications around it and using our internal application development teams. And those teams now are working on microservices. As Sanjay mentioned, and these microservices are very quick to change according to the location. So we have global presence. Somebody wants something in US, somebody wants something in Canada or any other country. So we can quickly change this. And that is what we are doing. We have mobile application, as Debashish mentioned. It's a interface for accessing all the applications. You can have your persona. We are also creating actually a data lake. So all the reporting requirements are going out. So we are creating data lakes. We are pulling data from our OT systems, our IT systems into data lake, and then giving and creating data marts, data warehouses, and our Power BI visualization layer. Whatever your data you want, you don't have to get into the application, especially for the executives. I'm not talking about people who are doing the transactions. The core system remains, but the consumer of the information, that is a single dashboard which gives them the entire information about their business. That is what we are doing. And we are heavily depending on the microservices. Right? But just before that, I want to ask one question to Rajeshri. So Rajeshri, when can we have, like everybody is talking about pay as consumed. So when can we have this network bandwidth on demand? Because now we have, as Debashish was mentioning, there are instead of 20 offices, there are 20,000 offices. But then how do you make sure that each office, each 20th office gets the bandwidth, the required bandwidth? Okay, so can there be a model from Tata Communication where we have, as per the consumption, okay, I get charged or a customer get charged as per the consumption, and there is no bandwidth issue at all.
Sure, Mr.
So, you can respond to that and quickly wrap up in a minute or so. Yeah.
Sure. We'll have to. So, very good question. Interestingly, we are already working on it. And this is something which is very much possible in a private network, becoming a bit difficult in public network. And since all of you are shifting towards public, we are trying to find an answer on the public front also. But in the private network, it's very much possible, right? Shyam said, let me try and put down the points which I heard from almost all of you. So I'll start with you, sir, Mr. Mehta. You talked about resiliency, and you said it's extremely important. And then, of course, you said that at the end of the day, if we can get services on the tap, right? And this is something that, Mr. Mehta, is a global ask, right? We are hearing this from a lot of customers. Then Mr. Kota talked about transformation happening in all domains, and therefore it is not something which is the responsibility of the employees, but it's more a board level direction which is driven by the CEOs, the individual CEOs. And also, Mr. Kota said that it's both about resiliency and agility. It's not an or, where a package system is coming in, which can then do both agility and resiliency at the same point of time. Right? Mr. Debashish talked about the shift from pre and post, and the whole ecosystem, the way it has shifted. How the reliance on public environment has come in, and the importance to work with partner who can understand the nuances, because here we are not talking about only one point of origination, but multiple points of origination for the consumer or the employees. Mr. Harnab talked about, it's not only about giving IT support when people are working from remote, but also focusing on their mental and physical health. And in doing so, how can you do it faster, quicker, and still meet the requirements of the end users? Naveen spoke about a very interesting thing in terms of shifting to monolithic to microservices, which triggered a lot of discussions post that. He also said that while they are already on the cloud, the shift towards microservices will ensure that they are well prepared for the surge of traffic in the future. Earlier, they could handle 3x traffic, but they are now prepared to handle much more surge in the future. Finally, Mayuresh talked about a very interesting thing, that they were the first ones to implement DMS, and that was in the 90s, where engagements used to happen on SMS. And now they are moving to cloud and also doing the entire shift of the users and their the systems to cloud, right? all these things point towards only one thing, that transformation is happening in almost everybody. And everybody talked about agility and resiliency in some shape or form, right? And therefore, I believe that it's an and not an or. Yeah, and that is what I take from this eminent panel. Back to you, Shyam.
Thank you. Thank you. So we are run a little out of time. So I need to thank. Yes, we tossed it from all the internal users, external users, technological changes, business requirements, the pandemic-led changes from all aspects, how do infrastructure transformation is being driven. We talked about that. Thanks for nice, very, very insightful comments from all the panelists. And thank you for turning up. Thank you for sparing this time to be with us. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks, everyone.
Thank you.
Thanks, everyone. Bye-bye.
Bye.